Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your amazing love and grace. We thank you for this opportunity to gather together. We give you thanks for each person in the room, online, and all the people who will be still coming. We are grateful for your love and thank you to be in your presence. And God, we long for you to touch us today in a way that is powerful and life-giving and true. Help us to know that you truly are our Lord and our Savior. It's in his name that we pray and bring our worship to you. Amen and amen. Amen, and thank you, Tim. Good morning and welcome to University Carillon, a community sent to help anyone and everyone become a follower of Jesus. My name is Jamie Westlake, and it is my great privilege to be one of the pastors here with you. And there's always a lot happening in the life of our church, and that is a great thing. I love our bulletin. On the front of the bulletin that you receive, You'll see some photos of the previous week and what we did here at University of Carillon, and a lot of great things. As you look up on the slide, you see all the great things we've got going on. One of those that we want to highlight is the Emmaus Bible Ministries. We've had a four-year partnership with this organization, and over 265 of us here at University of Carillon have participated in their school, their night class, and courses. And so we have the great privilege of partnering with them to help end biblical illiteracy and to encourage life change as people get to know God, as they get to know their Bible. It's a great example of living out our core value here at University of Carillon of kingdom mentorship. So you can read more about that in the bulletin. And then, as always, in the back of the bulletin, you'll find some of the ways that you might want to plug into the church in the upcoming week. And if it's your first time here, we give you a special welcome. We would love to connect with you. Also, there's a connect card in the chair back right in front of you. If you would, just let your offering today be to fill that out and drop it in the offering bag later on in the service. And we'd love to meet you after the service and connect with you about what's going on here at this church. And as always, there's lots of other exciting things happening, and you can check those upcoming events out in your bulletin and always on our website, universitycarillon.net. And so check those highlights out for the week. One of the things that we want to highlight this week is our new offering on Wednesday night. It's called Prayer Hour. We're just going to host a Wednesday night prayer gathering from 6:45 to 7:45. That's going to be in the choir room. Pastor Taylor and I will be leading that. And it's just exploring the ways that we can learn how to pray. If you feel like your prayer life is so incredible, so awesome, so wonderful that you don't need any help, then this isn't for you. This is for folks who know that they need help learning to pray. I am in that boat. I need to learn how to pray better all the time. And I need to hear God's voice speak into my life. And the Bible is filled with prayers that can help us learn how to pray. So we're going to be focused on the prayers that are in the Bible. Eugene Peterson says that if we want to hear God speak, then we should read the Bible. And if we want to hear God speak audibly to us, we should read God's word out loud. I like that. It's a good reminder that God's word always speaks to us. And so come out this Wednesday night as we celebrate God's presence in our midst. And of course, with Friday night, with Wednesday night dinner before that. And a group of our Friday moms will be going to Guatemala on mission in May. And so they're going to do something. They're part of a ministry called Filter of Hope. We wanted you to learn all about that. So check out this video.
Water. It can keep you healthy. Or make you sick. Those who have clean water take it for granted. Those who don't have it would give anything for it. It's the most precious resource on the planet. The lack of clean drinking water is the largest killer on Earth, affecting almost 1 out of 8 people. Every day, kids miss school, people walk for miles to find clean water, and more than 3,000 people die. Safe water is at our fingertips, but for many, it might as well be 1 million miles away. But it doesn't have to be this way. Filter of Hope has developed a revolutionary point-of-use water filter that is saving lives. It can provide up to 200 gallons of clean water per day and can last 10 years with very little maintenance. It's inexpensive and easy to use. They're small enough that we can pack several in a backpack, walk into a community, and in a few minutes, provide the entire neighborhood with clean water. Not only does Filter of Hope provide clean water, but we also use the filter as a physical illustration of the gospel. The filters are inexpensive, easy to use, and a powerful tool to change lives, both physically and spiritually. Will you help give life to a family in need?
And their group of them will be on the porch. You can learn more about that ministry today as well. Also, later in the service, we'll have Holy Communion today. Remember that we have open table communion here at University of Carillon, which means you don't have to be a member here or anywhere. You simply want more of who Jesus is flowing into your life to receive. We'll have three stations, and you are welcome at the appropriate time in the service to come and receive. And as we stand to worship God with our opening hymns, would you please greet one another in Christian love?
Christian, love me more.
for our responsive reading, which comes from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 11 through 13. No discipline is enjoyable while it is happening. It's painful. So take a new grip with your tired hands and strengthen your weak knees. As we continue in our worship, you may be seated. Lord, it is always such a privilege and joy to know that we can come to you with whatever it is that's in our heart and on our mind, and we give that to you just as we are, and you work with it, and you help us to experience more of your love and grace. Help us to know that you are personally with us and for us. Help us to really know the depth of your love and the power of your grace. And Lord, in the midst of, as we sang that song, O'er the Tumult, that's like there's a lot of tumult in the world. And so, Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit to hover over the chaos and bring peace and light and grace and hope and mercy and to help us live in a way that is a part of the solution to the tumult in the world. We want more of how you do things in heaven to become the way that they are done here on this earth. That is our hope, that's our prayer, and that's what you taught us when you said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now as our ushers come, we'll receive our morning offering.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord, for each of these gifts. May they truly help us to do your kingdom work right here, right now, through this church that you love so much. Thank you for each one of the givers that is represented as well. And may you bless their lives and help all of us be open to your Holy Spirit more and more flowing into us. In Jesus' name, we all agreed and said, amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, good morning. If we have not met, my name is Craig Bloker, and I have the great honor and pleasure of serving as one of the pastors here at University Carillon. This morning, we'll be looking at a passage of Scripture that is thoroughly underlined in my Bible. It is one of my all-time favorites, and it's actually an intro for Vessel moving forward, but it'll be a one-off here for the first two services. But we will join together in turning our hearts, our attention to the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. The writer of Hebrews, the preacher of Hebrews, says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, I've never been to Springfield for the Basketball Hall of Fame or Cooperstown for the Baseball Hall of Fame, but having grown up in Ohio, with family in northeastern Ohio, we would regularly make pilgrimage to Canton and to the Pro Football Hall of Fame. So just as an exercise of my own interest, I always love doing this when anything in Ohio comes up. Who are Ohio folks in the room? I know, and Central Ohio, you can't go too far with some Ohio folk around. Thank you. It just always feels comfortable. Like if you're in a foreign country and you see a McDonald's or something, you're like, right, we're not that far away. And that really is the case with Ohioans in Central Florida. But we would make regular travels up to Canton, and we would visit the Pro Football Hall of Fame, and we would visit the bronze busts of all of the players there. Now, our passage this morning must be read in context of the chapter immediately preceding it. The first word of our passage this morning is, therefore. Our passage is connected to that which had come before. And so in light of that, therefore, we are encouraged in the race of faith that marks each of our lives. In chapter 11, we see this long passage of the Hall of Fame of faith, as it were. The preacher of Hebrews is mapping out for them and those original hearers of this sermon, that is the book of Hebrews, would hear all of the titans of faith, those great Hall of Famers. And he walks through from the very beginning of Genesis all the way through. We have Abel and Enoch. We have Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, and Moses. We have Rahab and Gideon, Sarah, Samuel. And he lists out all of these kind of people, titans of faith. The bronze bust, as it were, the Hall of Famers in the Hebrew faith, which would have comprised most of his audience. But then he says something that was interesting in verse 39 and 40, immediately preceding our passage this morning. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, that only together... Now, this is the part that would be the most audacious, and those readers would probably fill in before the preacher would get here. That only together with Jesus is probably what they would fill in, right? That they had faith, that they, as God's chosen people, They had been the examples of faithfulness to the story of redemption that God had called and is calling his people. But that's not where the preacher goes. It says, better for us that only together with, not with, with us, would they be made perfect. That the careers of these Hall of Famers of faith, unlike the careers of those who have bronze busts in Canton, their career is not yet finished because we are still in the race. That their faith, even as the paradigms of faith, right, pillars of faithfulness throughout the Old Testament, that their faith is not made perfect, but for those who are still running, those people, those children of God, still running the race of faith. And we see this transition here that the preacher uses from a multi-generational pilgrimage to this baton being handed off, not just from all of those that had gone before, but that baton is handed off to us as well, even this morning. And the scene shifts, not just as kind of a passive voice, right? Remember those great examples of faith, that they would serve as an example to us, like we might read a biography. And we can learn from lives of great men and women, and maybe it can apply some things that would help us as we seek to live lives as well. The shift is not just that. The shift is inactive, that there is the shift from a pilgrimage to now it's an athletic competition. Right, we have entered the race. And the word here, agon, which is actually the root for agony, right? The same root, that there is a moral and ethical struggle that is before us as God's people. As we continue running the same race of all of those that have gone before us, named and unnamed. And the image shifts to almost being like in a giant sporting arena. That we have received the baton and we have run into the stadium. The preacher is writing to people who are weary in their faith. People who have faced trials and tribulations, whose the weight of life feels burdensome. They have lived enough life that it is difficult. And they are encouraging them. Now you have received the baton. You have entered the arena. Now, we had a nephew's birthday, and as it is in our family, we're all Gators fans. And I know I at least have one Ohio and Gator fan in the room. But we drove up to the Orange and Blue game yesterday, the spring game for the University of Florida football team. And we were able to go out onto the field afterwards, which is always a cool thing, right? Like, this is where all of the, like, people who are good at this do, and we just cheer, right, from the stands. So to go on to cross the threshold onto the playing field is always a neat experience. And Andrew and his cousin had a great time running around and pretending they scored a touchdown with an invisible football and all the like. But I've always imagined, what would the feeling be, right? If you're a UCF fan, a Gator fan, or, Lord help you, a Seminole fan, if you're in the locker room, and they have, like, the gate, right? And often the coach is, like, holding the players back. And then they get the green light, and everyone streams out onto the field. The feeling, the exaltation, the energy that you would receive running onto a field full of tens of thousands of screaming fans, knowing the contest that is before you, right? It's a little different field than running out onto the practice field. Right? If you're running out and there is a whole crowd of witnesses cheering you on. Now, I've never, Pastor Jamie has, but running a marathon, and that there are people lining, and especially near the finish line, that there is a crowd that is gathering, that as the race and one is growing weary, that there are those cheering you on. And as your body is feeling like it is failing, as you're reaching the ends of your limits of life, you are not alone in this contest. In fact, those that are cheering us on are those whose faith is perfected in our race of faith with God. That we are surrounded, we are not alone. The preacher is encouraging this first audience and encouraging us today that we have received the baton, that we have run into the stadium, and that we are not alone. that even through the trivial minutia and details of a week that we may have, that there is a great cloud of witnesses that is cheering us on. This is not a passive Hall of Fame bronze bust kind of cheering on. This is something living and breathing. Now, a refrain that I have is we have raised some small children, and that they're still with us, so we've had some, you know, modicum of success in this, is that in those parts as a parent where you're anxious for your children, I always remind myself that the human race still exists. And for much of the human species, we have far less resources or safety than our kids have. And somehow, the human species has made it until today. So surely, we can make it through, right? That they are maybe a little more robust than we think. But that's more of a passive thing, right? They've made it to here, and so I can just have a passive reassurance that we can make it through another day. The reassurance here that the preacher gives is one that is active, that we have run onto the field, that our faith is actually bound up, not just with one another in a room, which we can kind of conceptually get, right? We gather, we worship together, we pray together, we serve together. But rather, our faith is tied up with all of those, that great cloud of witnesses. This is why church is so important, especially parents and grandparents. Now, this is a reassurance for those. I'm sure some in the room, we have children, we have grandchildren who in their race are dragging, maybe are a little distracted, have run off course a bit. That it begins with the prayers that we pray for those that we hand off the baton of faith to. Some, the gun might have just gone off in their race, but that the life of faith is one meant to be of cheering and encouraging one another on. It is why Aaron and I are so thrilled to be a part of this church. We're just 2 points in the great cloud of witnesses, right? Now, on this side of glory, cloud of witnesses, God willing, for a number more years. But 2 points in that great cloud of witness for Andrew and Josie. But if it's just us, it's insufficient. It's because they have a number of adoptive aunts and uncles and grandparents, that they have college students and high schoolers and middle schoolers and peers that they can learn from, learn how to run the race of faith. Second, therefore, we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. Therefore, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. We are running a race. We have to be equipped for the proper race. And I think it's interesting here that there's not just the negative things, right? Just to avoid the sin that so easily entangles. I think we can understand, right, in a race that it's easy to go off course. That there are obstacles that we might trip or stumble over. That there is the temptation when the lactic acid is building up in our muscles and we feel that we can't make it, just to bail, to give up, to say maybe next time. But it's not just to throw off the sin that so easily entangles. That there is a admonishment from the preacher to us this morning to throw off everything that hinders. We have to know, friends, that we are in a race, that the life of faith, the image is used as a race, and we have to be equipped properly for the race. Now, C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters gives this beautiful picture. Now, in Screwtape Letters, got to read it in reverse. It's a wonderful book, but it's two demons talking together of how they can pull their patient away from a faith in God. And the demons confess to one another that they don't have the ability to create new, true loves for people. All they can do is to lean into and to distort and disorder the right loves that only God can create. That we are to throw off all that hinders is the encouragement. Now, what I'm about to share with you, I received blessing from Aaron. I try not to use any sermon illustrations without first receiving blessing, lest I don't have a place to return home Sunday afternoon. Now, if you've ever been up to my office upstairs, you will see that I am no minimalist. My walls are covered with picture frames, and there's all sorts of things on the shelf that have been picked up kind of throughout life as little examples to me. It drives our director of communications nuts. He's much more of a, like, it's just way too much going on for him. His office is much more simplistic. So I am by no means a minimalist until it comes to packing. Now, if I'm packing for a trip, there is going to be nothing in that bag that I know I do not need. And most places, we can just pick it up when we get there anyways. If I don't have something I need, there will be somewhere that I can get what I need. Now, this is not a shared priority amongst everyone in our family. So I brought along a picture of a recent trip that Aaron and I took. And so this is, we took the subway. So this is upstairs and downstairs and everything. So we got big roller bag, item, personal item. Aaron has hers, but I'm like, all right, this is my duty. I don't do this begrudgingly. Like, this is my duty. But I carry in. Now, I bet you could guess which of the two roller bags would be my bag and which would be Aaron's bag. Now, to her defense, I don't need to bring things for hair maintenance, right? There's no special equipment needed to maintain what is left of this, where there's a few extra paraphernalia that has to be packed in Aaron's bag for that. Now, some of us try to run the Christian faith like this. We're dragging along all sorts of baggage that is not required of us, that God is not asking for us to carry, that we carry great weights. It slows us down. It doesn't keep me from going where I am, but I promise you I'd walk a lot faster if I just had my feet and what I just needed for the next event on the journey. N.T. Wright on our passage remarks this: but far too many Christians try to run the race of Christian pilgrimage while carrying all kinds of heavy baggage. Anxieties about trivial concerns, ambitions to use the gospel as a means of self-advancement, resentments at other people, secret greed for bodily appetites, and so on. Friends, the encouragement that God invites us into, and if we know that we are running a race of faith, that's the image and picture that we are given of what it is to be a child of God pursuing the person of Jesus. What are you carrying around that God is inviting you to lay down, that you can more nimbly, more effectively, more productively walk the path that leads to light? The passage continues, and let us run with perseverance, for perseverance. Now, with kids, that could be a great trait, or that can be a maddening trait. Our oldest, Andrew, has recently started piano lessons, and he has had great perseverance. He wanted to learn a song, one of his little sister's favorite songs, on the piano. And he had it printed out in kind of rudimentary form of, like, actually reading music for the first time. And that kid would not get off of the bench of that piano until he made it through that song. That's a picture of perseverance. That's the perseverance we ought to have. Now, on the other hand, Lord have mercy, when he is persevering, asking the 1,000,000th time for something that he has already received an answer to, that we have reminded through, right? That he's our child of that, right? A locked door is just an opportunity to keep knocking or to try the next door, right? One down. The picture of perseverance, we are to run with perseverance. Now, for Andrew, it is a desire. There may be something that he wants, and so he will just keep going, and he will try any angle to try to get what he wants. And then when we try to call him out on it, he'll say, I was just saying what I wanted. I said, oh, Andrew, I promise you, Mom and Dad know what you wanted. We never have any doubt what you want. What if that kind of perseverance marked our faithfulness and following of God? What if we continued to knock? Because it's not just here. We see all throughout Scripture this image, this invitation that God has, that those who come and knock, the door will be opened, that those who ask will receive. Now, sometimes, like Andrew, we ask God for things, and it's going to just lead to more baggage to carry around in life, if we're being honest. But the invitation that God has is always for his children, for his people, to experience a greater fullness of life, to experience greater healing and transformation and growth, that our lives, wherever we are in our races, nearer the beginning or nearer the end, that we have something to offer the people of God as we seek and fix our eyes on Jesus. Because friends, our feet follow what our eyes are looking at. So wherever we have ended up, wherever we find our feet planted, is likely because there is something that is where our eyes were directed. The invitation of the preacher of Hebrews says, we fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Now, in our culture, we'll celebrate all sorts of firsts. Armstrong and Galileo, the Wright brothers. If I just say those names, we know what they did. The first of Jesus is the first. The journey of Jesus is the first journey that conquers death, but not just to conquer death, but to offer life. Life in its fullest. Life in its fullest on this side of glory. It says, for the joy set before him, Jesus kept his eyes on the prize. From Hebrews 2:10, so that he would bring many children to glory. And I love this. He's the pioneer and not perfect example of faith. He is the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. That as we look to Jesus, as we set to run the course that Jesus first established, it's not an invitation to run the course that God himself has not run. Jesus has run the course. And as we set our eyes to Jesus, that we would have our faith perfected, purified, clearer, that ourselves, our countenance, our being, our bad temper, our misordered desires would become every day on our journey as we make our way towards our own finish line, a clearer picture of the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, Jesus Christ. And as we close, a name that you'll hear of a lot more over the next few months and is actually coming to visit us in October is David Thomas. And he works with Seedbed, who's kind of the publishing arm for Asbury, and was a part of the recent Asbury renewal and revival. And he describes awakening like this. Put simply, awakening. We're following the path of Jesus, the invitation to walk the way that leads to life. Put simply, awakening is the transformational process and outcome of following Jesus Christ. It is both personal and communal and societal movement from which we experience a movement from darkness into light, chaos into order. Death into life, despair into joy, anxiety into peace, poverty into flourishing, brokenness into wholeness. That's the invitation that God has for each of us this morning, that we would throw off that which hinders, that we would avoid the sin which so easily entangles, that we would run with perseverance, but lastly, and really firstly, that we would fix our eyes upon Jesus. And that in doing that, our lives would be far greater than a bronze bust in Canton, Ohio, but that our lives would serve for our friends, our family, our neighbors, our coworkers, those to whom we care deeply about, would be a living testimony of the grace and goodness of Jesus. Amen. So we come to the table and we come and visit Jesus in the upper room, that on that last night with his disciples before he was betrayed, as he was nearing the finish line of his race, that he would be received in glory, that he fixed his eyes on the joy of completing the race, even through the deepest and darkest of trials and tribulations, that many of his children would join him in glory. And in that meal, Jesus took a loaf of bread. He broke it. He gave thanks to his Father. He offered it to his followers. He offers it to us today and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to his Father, offered it to his disciples, offers it to us today, and says, take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. With those who are assisting with communion, please come forward. Almighty God, as we come to receive again a physical embodiment of your grace, that you are here with us in this moment, that we take into ourselves your grace, your love, your hope, your redemption into our bodies, that we would be people who run with perseverance the race that is marked before us, that we would be encouraged along the way by those that have gone before us, our loved ones, those pillars of faith through the Old Testament, that we are not alone in our journey, and that their faith is actually perfected in our fixing our eyes upon you. This is what we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. The table is set, and as Pastor Jamie said, all are welcome to come and to receive the grace of God. So please come forward and receive as you feel led.
Love and grace, and for this time of communion. We love you. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our closing hymn. You don't want me. Aren't you glad that she has to race up here instead of letting me lead that song at the end? One of the things about repentance that's really important is we oftentimes focus on what it is that we're trying to turn away from. But I think it's important that we remember who we turn toward and to. We fix our aim on Jesus. And when he's looking at us, he's not screaming at us. He's not yelling at us. He's saying, welcome home. Go in peace and serve the Lord in the knowledge of his great and abundant love for you. If you need prayer, Pastor Mike will be over in the prayer corner. God bless.